every year that goes by, you lose one curator, basically, unless we start doing repeats. I wouldn't mind having Tom Warrior again, just laying that out there. Does it become harder for you to pick the right person every year? Do you feel that your market is dwindling, or are other people rising up as well and becoming curator level kind of people?
It's both. Sometimes I am very active on the Roadburners group on Facebook. I see many people throwing names, and sometimes it's overwhelming because a curator needs to be someone that actually wants to do this. It's hard work. It needs to be somebody like that can open doors. It's somebody who's communicative and really wants to do it. And being in this scene so long and happen to know so many of potential curators, sometimes it's just very hard to say why someone is really up for it and why somebody else is maybe, I don't know, it's hard. Sometimes it's very, very hard. And I think after having now curators for like 11, 12 years, it's starting to get a bit, I'm thinking about like doing curatorship a bit different next year to have something new to the table. And it's a constantly evolving process with curators. And as I said, sometimes people need to be up for it, and it takes a lot of dedication from the curators, like, and not everybody has time or even has the personality to do it, because they are like really good at making music and really good at their artistry. But being a curator, suddenly you're a promoter. You have to reach out to bands, you have to reach out to your friends, you have to throw numbers, and that's a completely other ball game. It's not like, hey, I'm friends with this band, and suddenly your friends coming back at you, we're gonna play for you, €40,000, please. Like, for instance, but that's something you have to deal with this. And this is the hardest part of being a curator. As Thomas said, you are gonna getting involved in economics, and that's a completely different kind of thing.
Yeah. And also, like, I think also with the curatorship, this was not the question, but like you feel a responsibility for the people at the shows. Like, I want them to like this, but you also feel such a responsibility to both them, but also for the bands that you invite, as most, or like, a lot of them are friends, and you want them to have a good time at Roadburn and have a good reception and everything. So like you put yourself on the line a little bit. With a lot of people, you know.
Sorry that's so hard to explain. As Thomas said, it's scary. Like, it's scary for the curator, it's scary for me, and it's scary for the both of us, because we are going to collaborate a whole year together, and we talk about things. You get differences, and you need to, like, really, as Thomas said, the curator is suddenly not only a curator, he's a festival promoter. Has to think about the festival and what it's all about, and that is something completely different than being on stage.
You learn a lot. It's very fun too, so don't be too scared.
Thomas aside, we'll talk about that guy later. What are some of the best memories that you have from past curators, of some experiences in developing the curatorship with them?
Like, each curator brings something very unique to the table. For me personally, I grow as a human being by collaborating with each and everyone. You start to understand. You start to understand why these people become these figureheads in the scene. Why Thomas is so well regarded. Why Jake Bannon and Converge are big. You also start to understand why Opeth is such a big band, or why Neurosis has such a cult following and are so well regarded. You start to notice, like, everything that has been written about people or what people say about these people, you start to experience it in yourself. It's very nice to see, like, now I understand why I like it. It's also with Jake Bannon, with John Baisley, with Voivod, with Sun. It's literally Tomb Warrior. And that's the most rewarding thing, I think, for me, is that I'm able to experience their artistic, I don't know to say, it's very, that's the emotional part of being able to work with everybody, that you start to know, like literally start to figure out, okay, they are on this level because, and then there is the personality of the people, and that's the most rewarding thing about working with everybody, that I'm able to actually really do something with them, like work together. And I have a lot of respect for everybody and for all the hard work that they have put into their curation, but into this music. It makes it extremely special.
This guy. Of the shows that you were able to see outside of your curatorship, what was your general top three, let's say?
There was a lot of running around to be able to see my own bands, actually. It was because of the things. I guess everybody here saw Wovenest. Yeah, amazing. What else did I see that was not on the curation list? I'm sorry, I still... Everything is Veron's fault today.
Right? Yes. Yeah. Yes.
But Anna von Hausburg, I think you liked.
Yeah. I mean, it's like except for the curation. Yeah.
I was assuming you saw three bands outside of your curation.
Yeah.
I ain't too high. Then.
I did, but can I look at the app?
You managed Wolven Nest, so yeah. That's what stuck in your
that's
mind.
Stuck
most,
so that's stuck
cool.
with me, but that always sticks with me. So. Yeah. I'll come back to this.
Yes. Yeah. And Walter, on the other hand, of Thomas's curatorship, and please don't say you run. What have you seen that has stuck in your mind the most?
For me, for Thomas' curationship, a loop on Friday night, I went completely berserk. God. And for the curatorship as well, Fontaine. Oh, that was really cool. I was especially very mesmerized by Heilung. But the thing that's God, Anna von Hauswolf, mind blown. Like, wow. What happened? I mean, Molasses, the curated projects, Molasses, Tom with the orchestra, it was like all expected. But, oh God, Anna von Hauswolf, I was like completely fucked. Sorry, I wasn't really prepared for that, and she captivated the room, and it was like, what most people don't know, we had like a hard time doing the Dow show last night with the Misfits cover set. They were originally planned to play the Hall of Fame at 12 o'clock at night, and we started to notice this is going to be such a big mess. So I have seen 1 minute of sleep, and for 2 hours we have been talking to security, to the Lady Bird skate park, to the Hall of Fame people, to actually make it happen that they could play the skate hall. So that show stands out as well. But I think the thing that stands out the most this year, it's the laid-back vibe among the other, like, everybody's into music, the laid-back vibe, and people are so into the music. And I'm not sure if everybody noticed, but the level of performances this year is insane. It's insane.
Well, we had one moment as well. We were fist banging to midnight,
really. Yeah. I forgot about that.
We needed that.
Yeah, we all needed that. I can still feel that show in my bones. I think it is safe now to open the space for any questions. You have these two people here, all available for you. Make the most of it. Bring it.
You first, please.
Yes.
I have a question about the direction of the festival. In some interviews, Walter, you say that the roots of Roadburn was like stoner, doom, and this year you try to go a bit further and get further away from those roots. Do you have an idea for next year? Do you want to get further, step back?
We will redefine heavy even more, but we will never ever forget our roots. So the roots of Roadburn, the psychedelic things, the all that Roadburn stands for will always be the core of the festival. Always, but that will never change. Though we will try to look for interesting new bands, young bands. We want to bring the bands that. The new generation of bands that do so many great things at the moment, but the core of Roadburn will what it always have been.
I think we talked about it as well, like an idea about what Roadburn is. It's really like bands that, or no, artists that challenges you, and that means you have to be challenged as well. You want to be challenged, and that's why it's like broadening into different areas every year, but as you say, the core is still there.
Yep,
it's all about the music that challenges.
Last year I spotted Tomas wandering here, yeah, and he became the curator. So this year we had Nergal. Does it mean he's going to be an expert?
If only it were that easy.
No. Nergal was here because of Tom and Tomas, and he came as a. He had heard many things about Roadburn. He approached me if he was welcome, and he was here as a fan, really as a fan, and I was blown away that he was just here. He was not backstage, he walked around, was at shows, and that's also things very overwhelming when you see these well-known people becoming the music nerds that they are. It's really special. We had people from Biffy Clyro here, and from other bands, like well-known bands, just being fans.
During At the Gates, Michael Stanner from Dark Tranquillity was actually on the front row going crazy. So it was a sort of Gothenburg death metal inception there. I was afraid the universe would end if they were touched. Questions?
Please feel free to ask questions. Please feel free to ask things.
Yeah. Scott, shoot.
I thought it was interesting you talking about the curation, and I always kind of had it in my head that the curator had his sort of budget and his sort of many bands to book, but it sounds really like maybe it's evolved more, but that now the curator is actually much more involved in the total festival than maybe in the past, and it's much more work for you, of course, than if you had to focus only on your 8 or 10 bands. That you have to have the whole vision, but I think it's a really interesting thing that you get to meld minds with Walter and make the festival even move in a different direction potentially.
Indeed, like in the past, the curator got the budget. I said, you have the main stage, there are 6 bands to book. Please go ahead. Let's talk about finances. But nowadays, the curator is literally part of the festival and the festival as a whole, and we feed off of each other. It's like. The curator and I want to really make the most out of it. That makes it challenging and daring, and that will make a good festival. Because in the end, it's you people who buy tickets. You come from all over the world. It's like a destination. And I feel very responsible about delivering the best possible festival because of everyone. It's what you deserve. And what I want, I'm walking around here as well as a music fan, and I'm doing this from like as a music fan, and I want all of you having a great time and have value for all the effort you put in coming here. That's what we spoke about as well. Yeah.
And it's like there is still the boring side of the budget and whatever amount of bands, whatever. But I noticed. Straight away, that it's all about dialogue with Walter, and as you say, like feed off each other. If I bring this band, like you want to balance what you ask, you know, like, oh, what could complement that and whatever. So I think it depends on who it is, I guess. But I mean, I see it as an excuse to nerd out and talk about shit with Walter. You know? That's, he helps me and I help you a little bit as well. It's like feeding up each other a little bit.
Tim, go ahead. We finally bump into each other, by the way.
So this year is the last year that Patronaut's going to be used for the festival, right?
Yeah.
So how does that affect the logistics moving forward?
Wow. Yeah.
Next question.
No. We are trying to find different options. It's hard. It took us by surprise. The Patronaut has been sold. It will be turned into like a showroom for like a big company. We were promised that we would be able to use it for many years, but we heard only like 2-3 weeks ago that that's not gonna happen. So basically after the festival we have to sit down, or 13, and we need to try and talk about many options what we can do, but we were completely taken by surprise that this is the last year of Patronaat, and Imperial Triumphant will be the very last show ever at Patronaat.
At least it's going out with a bang.
It's going out with a bang, but we really, really, really don't know at the moment what's going to happen, but we will find a very good replacement, whatever it takes.
I have a question for Thomas, for how the guests came to be for At the Gate show. Why? How did that came to happen, and why you picked them, or how they came into the thing?
A lot of them are friends, so it's like, and we worked together with Rob before on the record. It's just also about like which songs we wanted to do and how we wanted to arrange them, and that kind of builds into what kind of people we need, and people who understand what we do, and people who understand what this is. So it just grew. It's like you can't really control stuff like that. It just happens to happen in a way, but they're all very talented people, and you know, like the Yokoel chorded, like playing with real musicians. I can actually read sheet music. Wow. But it's just a beast that grows. But I was very proud to share the stage with those people.
Anyone? Oh, two of them at the same time. Fight it out amongst yourselves. You win.
Like a lot of bands, musicians go away, bands lost their members. Do you see a Roadburn without Walter?
God, no.
No.
No. God, no. Next question.
Question for Walter. So I've been trying to go to all the Thao sets. So my question is, how did the artist in residence concept begin? Was that something a band brought forward to you originally, or was it an idea from you?
No, it was like the artist. It came to. I was like, some bands are really capable of showing different angles of their artistry. They do different projects. It's bands that dares to bands that want to collaborate. So with the artist in residency, we want to honor a band, like artistically. We want to say like, hey, you have so much up your sleeve artistically, musically. You get like 3 or 4 sets over the course of Roadburn, and please play the sets that you want to do. Show these different angles. And that makes it, and it's always like very nice to see what band's doing. Like last year with Earthless, with playing with Damo Suzuki and Kikagako Moyo. This year with Dao, they were immediately, we want to do the acoustic side of things. We want to do a collaboration with Emma Wood Rundle. Straight from the start, we had to keep it a secret for more over a half a year. And they wanted to do the Misfits cover set because they grew up in playing garage boxes and basements. So it's basically the moment you approach the artists in residence, they immediately know what they want to do and they throw their ideas, and it makes it a very, very nice part of Roadburn. Especially if you have to arrange a skate park at like 9 o'clock in the evening. Ooh.
sure that was a lot of fun.
No, the rewarding thing is like they were rehearsing in the dressing room. I came in and I said like, hey guys, we have the skate park. These people were lit up like shining and they were like yelling through the dressing room how happy they were. They became kids, like they became the 16-year-old self, kids like rehearsing at mom's garage.
It's what Brian said when they stepped up on stage, you know, we've been miserable and we've been stupid, let's just have fun tonight. And I think that showed really well in that show. Anyone else? Someone back there? Yes?
Walter, you mentioned a few times about the Roadburns group. How much are you influenced with choosing bands by what you see people saying? Oh, this band would be really great. Do you pay so much attention to that? And also the Weirdo Canyon Dispatch, we have wish lists in there. Do you really pay attention to what we ask for? And say, oh, okay.
I pay a lot of attention to it. No, I live online most of the day. Like I'm most of my world is the virtual world of music. I read it all, I listen to it. About like 90 out of the 100 bands, I'm like, oh yes, please, immediately, sign me up. Where is the number of the bookings agent? So, and then I'm like, and then the bitter reality kicks in. Like, Roadburn, yes, you're a big festival, a big name. Comes down to economics once again. But I am literally following everything that's thrown at the what people discuss at the Roadburners group, and I'm always very surprised how many people are exactly in the same mindset as I am, and it's a nice what's the proper word? It helps me a lot, but the downside is there's a lot of like. I feel sometimes so bad and so sad that I can't make it happen. And that's what people don't see. That sometimes we announce bands and then people start like, why haven't you announced this band? Or why don't you have known how hard I tried? And I don't. It's a weird process to get bands or not. I know people are like asking for Dead Can Dance, for example. Or these kind of bands, but their production needs are so elaborate and it's so difficult, it's just not possible to incorporate these kind of things at Roadburn. And I see people asking for Tool online. I would love to have Tool, but like asking like tickets for €1,000. Like, and maybe I can find a sponsor and then we can have like Bud Light, Roadburn presents Tool, like, no.
Let's just see Tool somewhere else. But I guess that is one of the hardest aspects of your job. At least if I put myself in your shoes, I would go absolutely crazy. Managing people's expectations of the festival, right? That plays with your head, I suppose, even if you don't want to.
Yes, it's the hard part. As much as I love to have the festival with you guys, as I said, I share a lot about your question. It's every wish list I see part of the festival that I want to see as well. I can not make everything happen, and then it's the big dreading for the announcements. I'm a very emotional driven guy, and I know when announcing something, I know immediately I will disappoint like a lot of people by not announcing the bands that they really wanted to see. And that's still, I don't know exactly how to explain it, but it's like, I feel very responsible for what I'm doing.
But if everybody here would try to do what I you know, you get the insights of Walter's work, and I did this much, he does every year. So like, you get a more understanding for how it works,
yeah, but
and economics as well.
Yeah, economics, but it is inspiring. Sometimes there is bands mentioned that I hadn't on my radar, or it's new bands and I'm checking them out, and like for one example, like I was way too late to the party for Chapel of Disease. My God, that album is so fucking phenomenal. People were telling about it, and I was busy, and I was like, chapel of disease, whatever, like, no working. Like, one afternoon, I put on, like, working on Roadburn, put on the Bandcamp, listened to it, and I was like, okay, the biggest mistake of Roadburn 2019 is not having them on the bill. That's also what happens, just because there is so much, and then I'm like, I wish I had paid a bit more attention to what people were saying.
So is that your first confirmed name for next year then?
I have literally nothing confirmed for this year, for next year. It's a blank canvas until now. It's literally it.
As far as the program, is it, in my mind, one of the second most difficult things of the festival must be the time schedule. Do you have to really put as many hours as I think you do to...
He has to put 10 hours more than whatever number is in your...
It is like, no, the time schedule is the, it's the elephant in the room. This year, it was so difficult. Tomas went out. I spoke to Jose Carlos, and something didn't work out, and I said, please, Jose Carlos, make it happen for me. Oh, I do it in a minute. And like in a minute he changed it around and the one band had the perfect slot and he was like, oh my god, it's 7 hours that are like, what? Mm-hmm. Now, I know that the biggest thing I want to explain, we come back to Wuhan. No, of course, everybody saw it last night. Wuhan in the main stage, Maelstrom, Dolhoff, everything clashing together. Like, but let me tell you, Wuhan, 14 to 16 people on stage with an elaborate setup wouldn't be possible at Patronaat or Koepel Hall. So from the very first moment on, it was Uran closing main stage. And that was logistics. Then Dolhoff came together and they were like pretty insistent, like, hey, Aaron Turner told me, like, every time when I play a festival and Sleep is playing, they always put me simultaneously with Sleep. I really want to play a very special set at Roadburn, but please let me not clash with Sleep. I will do like the most amazing set with guests, but please don't let me play with Sleep. So you're going over the time schedule. Oh, it's between 5 and 6, it's Sumac. Oh, he's flying in at 8 o'clock in the morning. He wants to have a little bit of rest. Okay, let's put him on the final slot in the Koepel Hall. Oh, Dolhoff. Well, that's not like a real clash. Then you're like talking to the Dutch black metal scene about commissioning the music and having the project, and they are, we're gonna build it up, like we're gonna do all the bands, and it finishes with Maelstrom at the church. Oh, okay. Uran, Dolhoff, Maelstrom. People will get angry. Going over the green room, Jay Jail. Yeah. Interesting band. They need to play like a proper set. Clashing with Sumac. People will get angry. Them clashing with Cave-In. Ooh, in the end, I don't know anymore. Let's put in final. Oh, shit. You see that line coming. And then suddenly Brian from Dow is like, oh, we're going to do the Misfits cover set. But like, let's do it at 12 o'clock at night when people are shit-faced. And then you have a line, Dow, Jay Jail, Maelstrom, Dolhoff, Uran. Okay. We post it online and then people start like, why is Uran on the main stage? you start to have to explain, but it's 14 to 16 people on stage. No, but the running order is also logistics, it's artistically driven, and now I'm going to say the most awful thing, I'm also a traffic controller. I am managing crowds. There is on 2 square kilometers, there is 5,000 people moving back and forth. You have to manage that, literally manage that. And that's what we do with the running order as well. Make sure that people move around in that small confined area. and sometimes it's very difficult. Sometimes you do it on artistic reasons. People were talking about the Emma, the Dao, the Dao Acoustic and Lingua Ignota clash. It's a horrible thing to say. It's 1,400 people in the Koepel Hall. It's 700 people in the green room. You have to let it clash quite a bit to manage everybody, because if they were not clashing and they were like somewhere separate, then there would be maybe 2,000-3,000 people trying to get in the green room. And for me, the most difficult thing is, and the most heartbreaking thing is, I walked past the lines here at Patronat, and every time I'm walking past, I'm trying to hide, because I feel, no, but I feel really sad, because people want to see bands, and that's why we have had Foul Creature do a second show, and we had the skate park, but that is always the downside of it, when I'm not able to manage that people can see all the bands. But like, I think I spent 200 hours on the running order alone. My girlfriend knows, people around me knows this year. It literally drives me crazy.
When Walter reached out to me about that issue on that particular schedule, I wasn't being full of myself or anything. I really thought I had 8 or 9 alternatives, and I gave the 8 or 9 alternatives to them, thinking like, I'm the fucking man, I'm going to solve it. None of them worked for various reasons that I wasn't entirely aware of. That's how difficult it is. So I don't know how you do it, but just keep doing it.
It's difficult, and I know the moment when I put them online, we spoke about it as well. You know,
a few times.
You know when people will be very sad. It's all there. It's already, the moment I have it in front of my eyes, I can immediately tell where people will be very saddened. Though I'm not able to express myself that well on Facebook, and explaining logistics, it's just hard.
I think the upside of that, though, is that everyone has a unique experience in Roadburn. You know, you have to make choices, and they're always good choices.
I think that's a great final piece of wisdom. Yes, listen to Tim. Yes, I'm really sorry to the people whose questions I didn't have time for. Thank you, all of you, for being here. Thank you, Tomas. Thank you, Walter, for everything. And we love you all, but have a nice life. We're doing Death Consciousness in 15 minutes.